really glad you could join us today for our topic, is Agile Killing Stage-Gate? So first of all, I thought I'd run through a little bit about what Stage-Gate is. Not sure if everybody knows, and we'll kind of compare the two methodologies a little bit. So Stage-Gate originated with a professor by the name of Robert Cooper in the 1980s. His university studied winning and losing products. Why were some firms successful? Why every time they had a product, it was a success, and other firms didn't have that same level of success. And he found some consistent things that they were doing, and he coined the term Stage-Gate. That's actually trademarked to him. And his focus was to reduce risk and bring winning products to market. And it consisted of an idea to launch process. A lot of people don't realize it, but it was not and is not a project management methodology. So it really is about bringing a product to market, going through some stages of work. It's about reducing risk, as I said. And the methodology itself has some key items to it. There are things that you do in each of these stages, and then you have what's called a gate meeting. And in the stages, it's all about cross-functional teams, people working together. So people from, let's say, R&D, manufacturing, finance, and in the various stages, they have things that they need to do. And those things might be creating documents on assessing a technology risk or a market opportunity, understanding how production might be done against a product. The business case is a big one. In the methodology, in the early stages, you don't know so much about the product and whether it's going to be successful. So you're making more intuitive decisions. But what you decide at a gate meeting is really in the heart of the methodology, it's to fund the next stage of work. So it's not to fund the whole project. The core of the methodology was we've done our business, we've gone through concept, we're at a gate meeting to decide if we want to go to the business case. And what we have to make that decision are some deliverables and documents that were created during the concept stage. And the people who make that decision are cross-functional experts who can make decisions in the early stages based on relatively little data. As you move forward, you have more data, more confidence. The gatekeepers, they are called gatekeepers, and they will change in the various gates as you go along. So these are your investment points. The methodology says that the people in that meeting need to have the ability to write the check, to commit the funds for the next stage. And there is a stage in there, interestingly enough, called development. And we'll be talking a lot about what does development mean. Sometimes this is called a new product development process or an NPD process, which I think is where some confusion comes from. Sometimes it's called a new product introduction process. That may be a better term for it. And the process depends heavily on upfront having a lot of ideas. So the approach is you have a lot of ideas. If you don't have enough ideas, go get some more ideas, because what you want to do is you want to pick the best ideas and bring them through, and that's their products that come out at the end. And it's a funnel. And in fact, in the early days, in fact, I think still now, Cooper and Edgett, who wrote this methodology, would always ask the customers they work with, do you have funnels or tunnels? So it wasn't about start and go. You pass gate one and you're committed to go all the way through. It was about having those decision points and actually killing something. And a kill decision is something that those gatekeepers are supposed to be able to do, or recycle, send it back to the previous stage. It's also not a one size fits all. Depending on the scope of the product you're trying to create, you might need to go through a full five-stage process or maybe an express process where you start to combine things down, or even a just do it process. You know, you've decided this is maybe a line extension. not that difficult, not that risky. Let's just get it done. And you empower that team of people working on that accordingly. So if you've said as gatekeepers, we're going to let you just do it, then we don't need to be involved anymore. And you're just going to develop, test, and launch it. But if we think it's a lot more risky, then we may want to put some rigor and actually review your business case before you go into development. So there are variations of this methodology that different companies will use, different customers will use. Probably the biggest, most important decision that is made in the stage gate process and where it adds significant value is, are we ready to launch? So we've got a product, we came out of development, but the product is only part of what we need to be able to launch. We need to have marketing campaigns. We need to have our sales organizations trained. We need to have our delivery organizations trained. Maybe we have to have some key positioning done with some analysts, some press releases, advertisements, whatever it is for our product, stores lined up who are going to sell it if it's a consumer product. So all that other stuff, which is not necessarily part of developing the product, is really important. And that's what StageGate does very well. And they have something called a conditional go for all those checkpoints where you can say, because you don't want to bottleneck the process, you could say, you know, what I just reviewed, it's good enough, but I'm not comfortable as a gatekeeper that you've thoroughly thought out the competitive positioning. So go to the next stage. I approve that. I approve spending the money, but I also want you within the next 2 weeks to come back to this table and give us your perspective on that. So that would be an example of a conditional go. And so where the biggest confusion comes in, it's not an engineering methodology. It's not a development methodology. I have seen many times it used for development of very complex products. I worked in an automotive company, and they had so many stage gate processes, it made my head spin. And they had stage gate processes for developing their automobile, their engine, because it was so complex, it needed rigor. It needed really close decision points, approval points, checkpoints. At that point, it was more of a project management methodology, but it still had the concepts of stages and gates. And a project method, the difference between, I think, a project management approach of StageGate versus a product approach of StageGate is, what are those gates? Are they checkpoints? Are they evaluating project process, the progress of the project? Or are they evaluating the progress of the product? And at some point, that's a slightly different use of StageGate. So StageGate, being a nice framework, has been applied to engineering processes and in some cases very successful, but it adds a degree of heaviness and rigor. And at that point, it really is project management. So just to net out a few of the advantages and challenges around StageGate, one of its strongest items is it's cross-functional. So it brings together people from different disciplines into not only the project team to work on these cross-functional deliverables that they're going to give to those gatekeepers for decision-making, but also the gatekeepers themselves, right? So they represent the different functions of the company. It has the concept of process deliverables, things that people are going to do. And there are plenty of great out-of-the-box best practice templates of how do you do a scorecard to be able to assess probability of technical success. A lot of that came from the original work of Robert Cooper, but there's been lots of consultancy firm out there that have, including Sopheon, our own company, that have extended that. And there's governance. The governance model is very important. It defines the decision-making framework. How is it going to work? Who does what? Who decides what? What do they need to know to make a decision? What type of decision are they making? We call that the governance framework. It's challenges. The gates can be very rigid and very, very what are called hard gates. In other words, we're not going to go to the next stage until we have that gate, and that can limit its flexibility. The concept of killing products, we're going to be talking a lot about that later on. But even if a product is suitable for killing, it's hard to kill a product. You're invested in it, especially in those later gates. Nobody wants to bury products. People want to get them done and out the door. So the methodology says, well, just have so many ideas that you're not afraid to kill a product because there's something else to work on. And then what I call smart products. So those products which are a digital physical combination, it's challenged certainly to support the creation and introduction of those type of products. And we will talk more about those in this presentation. Now let's shift over to Agile. I believe there's probably lots of people on this conference who know it very well. But it came out of the software world. So there were problems with the way software was being done in the 80s, 90s, probably even way before that, was very much waterfall. So have a strong design document. What is this software going to be? What's it going to look like? Hundreds of pages of a design document. Then you go disappear for a period of time and build just that. And then you come out at the end and you've built it and it's great and it works perfect. And it's exactly what you said you were going to build, but it took so long, it's no longer what the consumers want. And so not only was that a challenge, but some of these would take 6, 12, 18 months between design and finish. And it had a lot, waterfall was overregulated, micromanaged. So in 2001, a lot of software leaders in the world got together and said, we need to do this better. And they created what was called the Agile Manifesto. And shortly thereafter, they created what was called the Project Management Declaration of Independence. We're no longer going to do it the way we used to. This is what we're going to do. And it's very radical. And so it's been very successful. So what it consists of is something called the backlog, which are small little pieces of software capability. You can think of them as like features if you want to, but they're things you need to do. And you select from that backlog ones that are deemed important and that can go together as a logical group. And you collect those and you go into a cycle. And the cycle is you have daily meetings with your teams and you go through maybe a 2-week cycle and you work on those items and complete those items. And then you reevaluate where you are. And then you pull more items from the backlog. And you might find that in those 2 weeks, something in the backlog is no longer appropriate. So you didn't waste time working on it. As you go through these cycles, some things will disappear out of the backlog, some new things will come in. And so what you're getting is a better selection. Some people think that Agile is faster. It's not necessarily faster, but it gets to the optimal solution quicker. So you didn't waste time developing something that you didn't even need, right? It's just a streamlined path through a set of features. But there's already one big difference in what I've been talking about. Stage-Gate has been, I was talking about physical products, products that sit on a shelf, products that you can hold in your hand. And the Agile, as it was in the beginning, was all about software products, something very different. So if we look at the advantages of Agile, it's fail fast, get something, doesn't work, you haven't invested a lot of time in it. There's something called a minimal viable product, which is a product that's good enough. Maybe it's not everything you planned it to be, but you know what? It's good enough. People would buy it. It would provide value out there. So ship that. And then you can easily increment software. Software is just very natural for that. As opposed to if you put a physical product in the field, it's not something likely you're going to upgrade unless it has software within it, which we'll talk about. The Agile process really reduces risk, and more so that you bring the right product to market. And so that's when I mean the target can change. The challenge is that the target can change, right? So now who's really defining what that product is? It's moving. Its endpoint is moving. So people in your organization thought you were going to create a product to solve a certain problem, and then what comes out is a different product, and that can be challenging for a lot of organizations. When we talk about smart products that are a combination of a physical product and a digital product. So think of almost every product that we use today. It could be the thermostat on your wall, could be your washing machine, the ovens in your house. Everything's becoming smart products right now. And Agile has some challenges with smart products we'll talk about. And also there have been challenges with scalability. So there, if you just look at the number of methodologies that are trying to scale Agile, there's a lot of them trying to overcome some of the shortcomings of what it was out of the box and different ways to scale it to larger organizations. So these are just some example ones out there. Probably, one a lot of people have heard of is called Scaled Agile Framework, SAFe, but there's others as well. So I've been using terminology, and if we just step back for a moment and compare our terminology, on a stage gate world, we have stages and gates, gatekeepers, deliverables, scorecards. In the Agile world, it's completely different terminology. And we talk about backlogs and burn down and Kanban. And this causes, as we'll talk about later, a lot of friction. If people in the organization understand stage gate, and all of a sudden they have to start talking to software engineering teams who are working in the Agile world, they almost can't speak the language. They don't understand the concepts. Likewise, if software teams have to deliver product with inside a physical team that is wanting to run a stage gate process, they don't understand, well, why do we have to have these gates? What do we need a scorecard for? Why is this product definition so important? We don't do it that way. We have a backlog of items. We don't have a documented product definition. So there's a lot of friction that comes out. And we'll be talking about that a little bit later. And then beyond that, we have what I call other agile use cases. So when the word agile is thrown into an organization, the software people hear it and they think one thing. But organizations are also thinking of agility, being more flexible. And the word agile gets thrown into that context as well. And there are agile ways of working. And a lot of that is the agile methodology that came out of the software world. It is, we're going to be nimble. We're going to take small pieces of work. We're going to evaluate those small pieces and see if we like them. Get some key stakeholders to tell us we're on the right track. So those concepts are what I call agile ways of working. And then there's the hybrid product. So the product that is just this mix of sensors and physical product and software product. And we talk about scaled agile. So if we talk about agile ways of working, and this is starting to be applied for even physical products now. Can we use Kanban boards? So the stage gate and all those deliverables we might be doing within a stage, well, they can be put into a Kanban board. And a small team of people could meet on a regular basis, maybe every morning if they're able to. Now you're starting to replicate what's known as a stand-up. And we're just looking at the progress of the deliverables in a stage, and we can use a Kanban board to do that, and we can achieve some good team dynamics and understand, are we getting the things done we wanted to get done in that stage? Using virtual technology such as Microsoft Teams or any of the other solutions out there, and doing more kind of just within that environment which people are comfortable working in. And then finally, we have something called NPD sprints. And I'll explain that in a little bit, but can we have a sprint, a 2-week kind of just effort in the stage gate physical product world to do something? And the answer is yes, we can. And we'll look at a few of those. So Some of the examples of these additional agile activities, end user research, product positioning, those kind of things where you want to increase market certainty. So you might, we'll give some examples of these a little bit later, but, you know, our competitive product review, doing a something, an assessment of price sensitivity, these lend themselves very well to small chunks of work that can be done in the same way that a sprint might be done for software. Or if we want to increase business certainty, you know, we want to test a package in the market. We want to have do some pilot plants, some pilot trials, those kind of things, product prototypes. Those things, even though we haven't actually committed to development yet, lend themselves to agile ways of working. And, you know, this is just scratching the surface. There are a lot of different methodologies out there. But, you know, the stage gate is being one of the most common and the agile being one of the most common. How do we bring those together? So where we see stage gate being used, it started strongly in chemicals. That was where its root was. Food and beverage, it's still very strong there. It's very strong. It's strong in consumer packaged goods, especially on the packaging side. You know, how do we take this product and for a promotion? Now we have in North America, the National Hockey League has its Stanley Cup, right? So if you have a product, you might want to brand it and package it just to support that, or Formula One season or what have you. It lends itself well to those type of products. It works well with single products, not very complex. It also works pretty well with technology development. Agile, I mean, clearly software or software as part of a hybrid product, or studies, right? We want to do some studies. They fit very well with agile. And the opportunity for both is when we have these hybrid products, or we have multiple engineering teams that need to be aligned. We have software applications themselves, as opposed to just software, but an application that needs to be sold and it needs to be launched to a market is a good case where there it can be some value added by StageGate around Agile. This is when Bob Cooper, who invented the StageGate process, you know, he's taken a crack at, well, what about hybrid processes? Where does it fit within StageGate? And some of the examples are listed here. You know, you could do these little, what he calls these little iterations to just within maybe trying to do your preliminary market assessment. You need to do those trials a little bit. And so voice of customer is a great one, right? We want to go out and have some short interviews by the entire project team. And we want to identify needs, problems, issues, right? They could be very, very fit, very well with agile sprints. And we could do them in North America, then do them in Europe, then do them in Asia. Or we might want to 3D print a mock-up of our product and take it out there and get some consumer feedback, right? And then do another one, and then do another one. And that's very much agile, sprint oriented, just keep turning the crank. They fit very well in those earlier parts of the stage gate process. They don't fit as well later on, but they do fit very well for upfront definition, lots of opportunity for agile type of methodology used within a stage gate process. So some of the problems with stage gate, I've talked about a few of these. It doesn't work for product engineering. I actually explored this in a recent blog post on our website. It's entitled When and When Not to Throw Out StageGate. And it gives some great examples on where StageGate fails. Effectiveness of gates, that's a tough one for a lot of companies to really get the gate right, get the right people in, actually stick to the discipline. Hybrid products are never killed, you know, they are refactored. In my world, they are refactored. We change the features, we switch the product up a little bit, but we don't kill the hybrid products. The business case can be too rigid too early. it's viewed as old because it came out of the 80s, as opposed to Agile came out of the 2000s. Maybe that's old too, I don't know. But it is viewed as old, and that's a stigma around it. Its value is often not understood or appreciated, especially by software engineering. The concept of linear stages can be problematic, and I think it lacks systems thinking. The product, these days, a product is not a product, but it's a portfolio of products or a portfolio of capabilities. And the stage gate view is it's a single product that comes in and comes out of the process. If we look at problems with Agile, well, Agile lacks business case. And in some organizations, lacking a business case, lacking of financials can be a problem. Not all teams can always be dedicated. It really relies on dedicated teams. And sometimes that can be a challenge, especially if you try to apply Agile to the physical product. Because while software teams can oftentimes be dedicated, hardware teams are almost never dedicated. People are always moving around. Alignment with corporate strategy is not always clear. It begins with the what and not the why. And I get a lot of challenge about this because people say, well, I start with an epic. And the people who write these epics in Agile think they're covering the why. But oftentimes, it is still the what. They're defining what the epic is. Not the true why, because the true why of an epic gets into alignment with the corporate business model and the corporate strategies. And oftentimes, you're so far down in any when you're writing the epics that it's hard to make that link back up and go directly back to how does this epic support our corporate business model. A lot of times the business model is not even known. Whereas the stage gate process would tend to do that because you've got these executives in these gate meetings making sure that happens. Sprint demos can be hard to follow for key stakeholders. You know, if you don't know where the endpoint is and you're seeing a little bit of work in a demo after 2 weeks, you're going to say, well, I don't see this, I don't see that, I don't understand, because maybe all that's coming in the next 2 weeks. So it can be problematic for organizations. Alignment with other processes, like the hybrid processes, is difficult. So in a hybrid world, we may have to take that medical scanner that we made, which has hardware and software in it, and go through a regulatory process. And the Agile guys say, well, wait a minute. I can just make an MVP and we can update it over the air later on. And the people, the product owners of the entire product get very scared about that. And they say, you don't understand. It takes us 3 months, 4 months, 6 months just to go through the regulatory approval of this product. And that kind of is a very different world. So alignment of Agile in that world can be sometimes a little tricky. Idea development, I talked about that, but it has problems as well. The classic stage gate depends on it, but the idea to product, just going straight through, as for some of the reasons I've been mentioning, is not a good approach. Products are not linear. Products are portfolios of features. And so this generation of ideas versus the portfolio management of features are kind of playing against each other. So today we have products in development facing severe challenges because of the global microprocessor shortage. Think of automotive. Nobody's going to kill next year's model of the BMW 430i. They're going to refactor it. It might be different than what they planned, and perhaps it's even different than what they had this year for this year's model. Maybe some capability is taken out of the next generation of that product, but the product will come out, right? So we don't need this linear product idea to release. It doesn't work with that type of product. And what we're really seeing is something like this. You've got features, alpha, gamma, delta. You've got products. The products contain multiple features. The features go in multiple products. So you've got this whole definition framework above that line there. And then you've got all the projects going on to make those real across all sorts of systems. And so we've got Agile software products, we've got maybe waterfall software projects, we've got outsourced software projects where we're buying the technology, so we're not even aware of what the methodology is. And we're trying to fit that in, let's say, with a stage gate framework or methodology that the product people are using. Manufacturing's creating all sorts of projects that they need to be able to manufacture the product. And that's a huge difference there is that this is just this network of things going on. So it again puts a lot of pressure on something like a simple stage gate process, but an agile process also does not solve this problem, right? But this is this product management problem that companies are facing. So you get this friction that comes between stage gate and agile. We've got different cadence, which we talked about, different timing, 2-week sprints, 3-month release cycles, or whatever they are for the agile world. And we've got longer stages, regulatory compliance. It's a different cadence. It's a different timing in the stage gate world. The minimal viable product concept, I talked about that. Updating over the air just sounds good in theory. Not every product can successfully do it, especially for the regulatory aspects. Physical products need to be designed, and they actually need to be manufactured. You don't need to manufacture software. You just can spin off as many copies as you want. The assembly people need to get that software burned into the chips or the firmware for production. So yes, there are definitely assembly considerations for software, but it's very different. I don't need a factory to build the software, but I do need a factory to build the car or the physical product. And the issue of dedicated teams, in some methodologies you can have it, in some methodologies you can't. So here's the question, is agile killing stage gate? Well, yes, some say stage gate's too rigid, not flexible. We need something else. It's all the same arguments from 2001 for agile against waterfall are now coming agile against stage gate. And it tends to be very software focused because the software people are saying, I don't really fit well in the stage gate thinking. But it's probably really a problem of applying the wrong application of a methodology. Is agile killing stage gate? No. Agile is too loose and undefined. We need more structure. Oftentimes these are defensive arguments, but organizations are making those arguments. Oftentimes a failure in the stage gate process leads companies to seek alternatives. Agile may not be the best alternative, but when you're finding something that's not working well and you say, what else could we do? And you have software people saying, I know what we could do. Take a close look, because that may or may not be the right way to do it. Because don't throw out the good with the bad, right? There are good things in stage gate. There are good things in agile. The best approach is really both in the right context, which is why I really give it a maybe. Is it throwing it out? Well, maybe. Maybe in certain places, yes. Maybe in certain places, no. If you think of agile as a development methodology, it fits quite well within stage gate. You know, this go to test. Go to development, that development stage, maybe even that testing stage, it fits well. By the way, when you see the word testing in the stage gate world, that is market testing. That is not software testing. So don't get tripped up with that one. But agile shouldn't be killing stage gate, but maybe it should be leveraging and improving stage gate. And to bring it to a software example, and I explored this in another blog post I did earlier this year, and the blog post is entitled, What Software Teams Can Learn from Physical Product Teams. And it's also out on our website if you want to go grab a copy. The software teams and physical product teams have a lot in common. A lot, and if you're trying to build and get over any kind of conflict, build on the things that are in common. And there's a lot of things that should be defined before software development begins. And I've listed some of them here. What we do in Sopheon is we manage our epics upfront using a stage gate process. They are managed much better. Before we commit to development, we make sure we understand the epics cross-functionally in our company, and we understand their business value and their alignment with our strategy. So we do that outside of JIRA. We do that in a different system, different methodology. And then they go into JIRA and then they follow our agile process. But we also make sure we understand the release. We write our internal press release. How much of it, our release is customer driven? How much is technology refactoring? How much is incremental innovation? How much is new to the world innovation? We want to understand all of that before we start just writing stories and starting to develop and going in our own Scrum process. So we find that it fits very well. And if we look at recommendations that I would make, just to sum this up for you, consider using both, but where appropriate. Don't force the wrong methodology onto your engineering groups. That's a recipe for disaster. Don't force your software to people to be Stage-Gate. Don't force your hardware people to be agile. Try to find that common ground. Engineering and product creation is not holistic product development. It's a piece of it. So what we often think of product development is only part of what's required to be successful in the market. So Stage-Gate can have a great use around those other non-development, non-product development pieces. Use a system demo to align your physical and digital teams. System demos have been around for a number of years now, and they are really great to plan to say, we're going to have a system demo 2 months from now, and the hardware teams need to bring, the physical teams need to bring this to the system demo, the software teams need to bring that, and that's just great integration points. So they are really a great way to bring those two different teams together. As I said, look for opportunities for Stage-Gate for non-development. I think launch preparation, launch decisions are really good. And try to take the good parts of Stage-Gate, the cross-functional, the governance, the templates. These are all really good things from Stage-Gate that even if you're in the agile world, consider using. So that's the end of what I prepared. I really thank you for the opportunity to present to you. I'm doing a consistent blog, and also I do a weekly podcast. The podcast is with other innovation leaders out there. Take a listen. If any of you want to join it or think you would want to recommend somebody be on it, I'm always looking for guests. I think the guest episodes are the best ones that I do. And Sopheon also has a number of other resources out there on our website. So feel free to dig into that. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Tommy, who will kind of coordinate us through any questions or anything else that's been coming up.
Oh, Paul, that was a really enlightening conversation, and thanks so much for presenting that. I have a quick question before getting to some questions that have been posed in the chat, and also if you want to come online and engage directly with Paul and have a conversation, that's fine. We can do that also. But my question is we have this kind of middle ground with. Well, we have these two approaches, right? Stage-Gate and Agile, but then we also have, related kind of this hybrid approach, where we have products, hard products, versus software products, right? Is there some type of fusion of these two that's coming together to create some type of a new methodology? I mean, I see kind of these parts and pieces being brought together from the two, but is there a new, I don't know, for lack of a better term, a reset or rethinking of how to run a process with both hardware and software coming together that kind of rethinks the whole thing?
Yeah, I don't know that we've hit the point where there's a major kind of like the next manifesto around it or the next discovery of Stage-Gate around it. But there are a lot of folks working on it for sure. You see the project management companies are trying to get to it. You see the scaled agile frameworks trying to extend their methodology to it. So both sides are kind of coming to it. Even Sopheon, we announced a product in this space to actually try to focus on exactly where those come together. So a lot of activity happening there. We realized in our product we just announced that the governance framework is very different for this kind of combined product. And so we spent a lot of time publishing our own governance framework around that. And we'll actually be launching that here, more of that in the next month or so. So I think there's a lot coming, a lot of people working on it. It is fairly new, but it is recognized as enough of a problem, Tommy, that that people are definitely working on it, including my company.
Awesome. Yeah, thank you. We have a question from Raphael who says, wouldn't you say that agile is for more innovative or unproven products or models that demand flexibility, and stage gates for proven core products? So that's from Raphael coming in via the chat.
Yeah, it's a good question, Raphael. And I think, you know, this is a classic question that a lot of people ask. The stage gate process, one of the nice things about it for unproven products is the identification very early on that this is new to the world, and the process can be created such that for those type of products, you should be bringing in universities, you should be bringing in startups to actually work with your company. So the larger organizations, it helps them be a bit more adaptable to those that act more like a startup, because the methodology can actually be structured to encourage them. So I've not seen that the agile versus stage gate is strongly typed that way. I think for what we've seen for line extensions is a lot of times they even skip the stage gate process. They just go straight to that just do it process, right? They skip all the gates. So I've not seen it as dramatic as you've put it out there, but it's certainly, they have advantages and disadvantages around that.
Awesome, thank you. Alberto states, and this is I thought he was talking about food. Oh yeah, but Alberto mentions around the food, you referred to food companies fits into stage gate approach. That's one of the struggles for innovation at his organization. Don't you see possible to include agile setups such as sprints in the ideation or explore phases?
Absolutely, and I absolutely do. And I didn't spend a lot of time, that one graphic was really focused around it, but yeah, you have a phase called ideation or a phase called concept, and it can just be loaded with all sorts of little agile projects within there. It fits very well. So when you're kind of upfront trying to identify, geez, is this idea real or is this concept going to work? It fits very well up front there. And that's what a lot of organizations do. So if they have software that's kind of managing their stage gate process, what they need is to be able to link into that stage all the agile process. So it's actually two set of software applications can be working together very effectively for that. It's perfect for that use case.
That's great. Anybody want to turn on their camera and their mute and unmute and check in with us? I know we haven't had any direct questions, but I want to make sure that before we close here in a few minutes that we offer up that platform to chat with Paul directly. We're not having any more questions coming in via the chat. I don't see. So of course we can wrap a little early, but I want to give you one last opportunity to check in with Paul before we close here. Eugenio, we do have a question coming in here. Which methodology is more applicable when we have opportunity to make proof of value with customers?
Again, I think it depends on the type of product and the way you can do it. So I'll give you an answer for both. So agile would fit very well because you want to have a set of things you're going to repeat over a number of customers, and you're going to go to different customers, and you're going to have maybe a canvas, an innovation canvas you want to fill out. And at the end, you want to do a retrospective because you want to say, how did it go? But it's a short iteration. You just keep iterating. And what you're not changing is the work product, but you're changing the customers you're talking to. So you iterate across a number of customers. So Agile fits very well with that. Where Stage-Gate would enhance that is before you start that proof of value, that there are deliverables. There are things that your organization needs to think about, and maybe some cross-functional leaders need to vet out to say, who are we going to talk to? What do we want to get out of it? How are we going to find the customers? Who's going to pick them? There's a lot of kind of other ancillary work that's not part of that agile thing that needs to get done. And that could be defined within a broader framework, like a stage gate, or maybe that's even too much, but the place where you're doing it, there's other things around that agile piece you're going to do for proof of value. So that's how I would do it. If I had to do it, I would think of, what do I need to get done before we do the iterations? What do I need to get done afterwards? How are we going to decide from what we heard, what we do with it? That's another governance question. And then in the middle, I would just use an agile methodology to execute across lots of customers.
That's good. Thank you for that. We're going to go to Martin.
Yeah.
Go right ahead.
Let's first start to say, Paul, that I'm a very happy Accolade user. So
hi, Martin. Glad to hear it.
Yeah. Now, then first, one thing that I really want to emphasize, because you said no business case for an agile project, and I think a lot of people link agile with Scrum, but Scrum is in fact the execution phase of an agile project. And if you do proper Scrum, I think that before you start a Scrum project, indeed you have made your business case, you have done the strategic alignment, and you see that also in many of the skilled agile frameworks that indeed they bring that element also clearly in. But that brings me with one tension that I find with, especially also when your software system is a little bit more rigidly organized. In agile concepts, you like an incremental launch, maybe, where your total business case and your total launch is this larger thing, which you traditionally would do in the launch phase of your stage gate process. But now I want to do my launch earlier, and then it gets blurry, especially when the system is not agile, and now agile with small a, not the capital A, agile enough to support it. How do you see that tension between stage gates and agile?
Yeah, Martin, it's a great question because the gate of am I ready to launch? If anything, during COVID-19, we saw products that were actually killed at launch or put on hold because they might have been insensitive, or they lost their market, or the timing was just going to be terrible, right? So on one hand, that decision to launch is a very important, hard, rigorous gate. On the other hand, it can't be, right, for some of the things you said. So I think there has to be there should be a hard gate that says, yes, we are ready to launch, but then how we launch, it might be a number of different either stage gate or agile projects. I don't think now this launch phase, this launch execution with, hey, here's what we're going to do, here's our activities and deliverables, that may not be appropriate in that model. What we may have to have is multiple launch projects, if you will. Some might be agile, some might have more structure around them, but it can't be just that one box at one stage called launch. And at the end you say, okay, post-launch review, how do we do? I think that's challenged in the example you gave, which was a great example. And I think we've just got to work on that and get that better.
All right, guys, thanks so much. We got to wrap here. We're already a little bit over, but thank you so much, Paul, and everybody for checking in today. Feel free to share your insights on this session on the Innovators platform, the community platform. Feel free to post additional questions there and continue the conversation. I think Abby has posted the link in the chat to the platform. And the next session starts here in about 8 minutes. And once again, thank you so much, Paul, for the great presentation and everybody for participating.
Yeah. Thanks for joining. Tommy, thanks for hosting. Take care.